All right, it's 3 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get settled in for our third and final session of Varieties for Textual Experience. This is a varied panel of folks looking at sort of popular culture and ephemeral publications, different kinds of textuality than we have considered before. And at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Pam and Lev, who will do the introductions. Same as before, these guys will also be the kind of point people for discussion after the papers, but we'll hold discussion until after all 3 papers have been given. So, all right, thank you guys.
So our first of our final 3 panels today is Marina Bilbija, who is a college fellow at Boston College. Her favorite aspect of teaching is also her favorite aspect of the magazine she works with, Seriality. In an email correspondence, Professor Bilbija explained to me how learning communities form by the continuous process of meeting once or twice a week in the same room at the same time. She wrote, every new class meeting is a new episode in the life of that community. And the success of each individual depends largely on the willingness of the class to conceive of itself as a community.
Our second is Ben Wheel, who is a visiting assistant professor in American Studies and Integrated Studies at Colby. He's currently completing a book about the role municipal stadiums play in reshaping urban space and conceptions of the public in post-war United States. Tentatively titled Coliseum Reborn, The Stadium and the Post-War American City. It will be published in fall 2016 by the University of Pennsylvania Press.
And our final panelist is Kim Schwenk, who is an artist, archive and rare book librarian, now working in the glamorous and adventurous book trade. She started making zines in 1987 and currently advocates for zines in academia and activism through her collective Girl Zines Go-Go. Am I presenting that?
Yes.
It's not the people we want to hear from.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you, Megan, for organizing this wonderful conference. So the talk I'm about to give today is kind of in a more presentation workshop mode. It is new work that I'm doing for the last chapter of my book project on Black magazines in the anglophone world. The title, as you can see, is on the very word list, Black Editorial Practices and Cultivation of Great Literature in the Colored American Magazine. And this is kind of a section of that chapter that I'm working on, which focuses mostly on reprinting. So this talk analyzes the centrality of Black editorial practices to the production of something called race literature at the turn of the 20th century. Race literature was the term that African American editors and writers used synonymously to African American literature. In the last 20 years, there's been a great deal of scholarship of the mediating role of white editors and publishers in the publication of 18th and 19th century African American texts. This talk examines the inverse dynamic, the intermediary role of an African American editor, Pauline Hopkins, in the 1904 reprinting of a novel by a white Victoria Holmes. I argue that Hopkins' serialization and reprinting of Harriet Martineau's 1841 abolitionist novel, The Hour and the Van, in the Colored American magazine can be read as a new African-American edition of the novel. Indeed, as Mackenzie points out, editors make as well as mend. So let me first give you some information about the journal before I delve into analysis of Hopkins' editorial practices. Founded in Boston, by Walter Wallace, Jesse Watkins, Harper Fortune, and Walter Alexander Johnson, and published by the Colored Co-Printed Publishing Company based in Boston in 1902. It advertised itself, and I quote, as an illustrated monthly devoted to literature, science, music, art, religion, facts, fiction, and the tradition of the Negro race, end of quote. This journal hoped to address both white and black readers and aimed to, quote, act as a stimulus to old and young, the old to higher achievements, the young to emulate their example, and to promote the higher culture of religion, literature, science, music, and art of the Negro universally. In contemporary scholarship, this magazine is best known as the original publication site for the novels of African-American writer Colin Hopkins, and these are Of Blood, Hagar's Daughter, and Winona. Even as scholars such as Hazel Carby and Hannah Wallinger have argued that the study of these magazine archives will give us a better understanding of Hopkins' legacy, much of the work of the magazine centers on her fiction and her essays rather than on her editorial texts. Yet, her biographers note that she took equal, if not more, pride in her editorial work. So, for example, in a letter to fellow editor Marlon Trotter from 1904, Hopkins made a case for the highly specialized nature of editing, noting that the expertise that went into editing a high-class magazine, her phrase, exceeded the skill sets required of writers. She explains that the Colored American magazine engaged her as a literary editor for reason one, because I was a well-known race writer that gained the confidence of my people, and two, because there seemed to be at that time no one else well-qualified to fill that position. For as yet, the editing of a high-class magazine was puzzling work to even our best scholars. So Hopkins' investment in the cultural work of editing needs to be understood within the context of her discussion of the figure of the literary worker and the heterogeneous activity that she refers to as literary work for the first time in her 1902 essays. In her monthly column on the biographies of famous African-American women, Paul and Hopkins jointly referred to poets, community educators, and journalists as literary workers, without making distinctions between writing, public speaking, and literacy outreach. In what follows, I examine Colin Hopkins' editorial practices as instances of literary work. In so doing, I call for the expansion of the objects of analysis of late 19th, early 20th century race literature, expanding its objects from literary works to literary work, recognizing the work of the editor of a race journal as constitutive to the building of a race literature, brings reprinting practices under closer scrutiny. We know that one of the key practices in any 19th and early 20th century journal in the anglophone world was reprinting of articles, poems, and fiction, whether from contemporary journals and books or early ones. This applies to British and American journals across the board. So it is not unusual that the Colored American magazine would reprint something that was much older. It would be reprinting in 1904 a book from 1841 that had subsequently been republished many times and was probably much cheaper to reprint, if not in the spring. The serialization of the novel began in February of 1984. Here you have the journal, the title contents for the first issue that had the Arrow Man. So roughly 6 months before Polly Hopkins was pushed out of the magazine by its new publisher and owner, Fred Moore. In the 3 years preceding this serialized reprint of Martineau's novel, Hopkins had serialized three of her own novels, Winona, Hagar's Daughter, and the Pan-African Romance of One Blood. Hopkins scholars and biographers often express disappointment that in 1904 she would choose to serialize a novel by a white author that had been in print for over 60 years, rather than using this opportunity to write more of her own fiction or to champion a burgeoning black author and host more instances of race literature. I suggest that Hopkins' reprinting of Martineau needs to be understood less as a departure from Hopkins' previous literary enjoyable work and needs to be seen as an integral part of it. So the imprint that she leaves on this text is race literature. Once we see it within this world of the African-American magazine. I have chosen Hopkins' reprinting of Martineau's novel for this talk, rather than any of the other one-off reprints, because her engagements with this text were sustained over time, serialization. My contention is that when reprinted, parceled out, and reformatted, text that we encounter in Colored American magazine is a new version of Martineau's text, mediated by Hopkins. In other words, I'm not arguing that book editions published out of New York and London in 1841 and 1873 were inherently race literature because they dealt with race. That's not why I'm saying they are not race literature. Instead, I'm suggesting that the serialized 1904 magazine edition, reformatted and recontextualized, to cohere with the general's agenda, should be counted as another form of Hopkins' contributions to race literature. So I'm thinking about the congealed labor of the editor. I refer to this as Hopkins' text, rather than the Colored American magazine's text at moments, only because the mission and the contents of the journal changed drastically after Hopkins left the magazine, and her departure coincided with the end of the novel serialization. I'll talk about that a little bit more at the end. So it is clear that it was Hopkins' decision to serialize this novel and not the rest of the editorial staff. There are three reasons for this. First, she was literary editor when the first installment came out. The serialization of the novel was stopped roughly around the time when she left. Second, Hopkins had extensively excerpted this novel 3 years earlier in a biographical essay on Toussaint Louverture that appeared as part of her series, The Famous Men of the Negro Race. And third, the serialization of this novel about Haiti began a little under a year after the magazine had announced that it had become international in character, boasting subscribers in Liberia, South Africa, Philippines, and Hawaii, and featuring items about places and peoples across the diaspora. Taken together, these three facts suggest that the serialization of The Hour on Demand was not just a filler in the journal. Hopkins had made use of Martineau's novel 3 years prior in a long biographical essay on Toussaint, which I mentioned. At a crucial point in this 1901 essay, Hopkins writes writes about Toussaint's life and his martyrdom for the Haitian Revolution. And then, as she's been feeling a biography of her own, she reproduces a long chunk of text from The Hour of Man. And almost seamlessly, she shifts from Martineau's text back to her own prose. Since there is no indentation or citation markings, the only sign that we're shifting from one voice to the other are the quotation marks. I think it's the right slide. Sorry. Okay, fine. Yeah, I think that slide's missing. I'm sorry for this faulty PowerPoint. At another point, she shifts from her own observations on Toussaint's bravery to those of the abolitionist Wendell Phillips, whose writings on Toussaint she reproduces verbatim without actually citing. So there is no visible demarcation between Hopkins' prose and Wendell Phillips's, or Hopkins' prose and Martineau's. Her weaving in and out of her primary sources can be read as a commentary or framing device for her reader, when she's who she's instructing in the history of abolition. She then excerpts Martineau again, creating a patchwork of narratives and narrative voices eulogizing Toussaint. I drew your attention to this earlier use of Martineau's text to show how the magazine had already processed it and inserted it in the most didactic form of race literature, the biography. Indeed, as Hannah Wallinger points out, biographical essays on famous men and women of African descent were the cornerstone of the Colored American magazine's pedagogy of race literature. Their aim was to create a pantheon of famous black women and men and remind the readers of their rich history and to supplement their political literary canon to which they may otherwise have no access through white journals or classrooms. Hopkins returned to The Hour and the Man in the February 1904 issue, in which she first advertised the novel's serialization and produced the first installment. The serialization of The Hour and the Man was announced as a replacement for Hopkins' Ethiopianist romance of One Blood, whose final installment had appeared at the end of 1903. Even though she was switching from her own novels, new original work by an African-American novelist, to the previously published and reasonably well-known novel of a Victorian writer, there were important continuities between these two texts. Both novels feature Afro-diasporic protagonists and communities. Both texts glorify the achievements of people of African descent and agitate against colonialism and slavery, and both of them romances. Hopkins repurposed this historical novel by Martineau about the Haitian Revolution to speak to the local and global anti-racist struggles of her own moment by publishing its serial installments alongside articles on national problems, so lynching and underrepresentation of African Americans, but also alongside items on national racial struggles in the Philippines and anti-racist figures in South Africa. So giving him new context to this previously just novel that was just about abolition. Two important factors distinguish the Colored American magazine's first installment of The Hour and the Man from the second 1873 book edition of the novel, which Hopkins acknowledges in the copyright section. The first is the capitalization of the word Negro. That's what you can see here. So. And this is kind of a very important change that she's doing, because by capitalizing the word, she is giving it a political category, political dignity, and in so doing is modernizing the text and make kind of bringing it into the updating it to the political norms of its of the time of its readers, and that's kind of one of the kind of most evident changes that she adds to the text. Viewed within the context of Hopkins' program to, I quote, unite and uplift blacks in all corners of the globe, the reprint of a novel about a momentous political victory of people of African descent is revealed to be an affirmation of Hopkins' race work rather than an aberration from it. This is especially true once we take into account that these editorial changes, juxtaposition of the novel's installments with other events and material. The first installment of this fictionalized biography of a Haitian race man, which is what she calls him, alongside a biography of a South African journalist, an activist, Alan Kirkland Soga. So within the April issue, she published these two pieces together, back-ending as bookends to the journal. And one is the section from the novel is kind of a hagiography almost of Toussaint, while the essay on Alan Kirkland Soga is a kind of biography of a contemporary South African activist who she sees as a race man. She calls both of them race men, once introducing Toussaint through Martineau, and then by writing this biography of Soga. By publishing these two pieces together, she compressed the spatial and temporal distance between them and sutured their missions, you know, creating a pan-Africanist patchwork. Hopkins' limiting of these two diasporic figures was further enforced by the fact that Soga's own monthly column, called the Black Marriage Conference, was being serially published at the same time. So Soga is published every month alongside Martineau. And even before that, he had published a phaeton in 1903 entitled Ethiopians in the 20th Century, which was, again, a group biography of famous Afro-diasporic actors. The same February issue that reprinted the first installment of The Arab and the Man and Soga's biography featured an article entitled Do Not People Read the Bible with Their Prejudices? By Reverend J. Allen Viney, whose title was a riff on Wendell Phillips' much-quoted indictment, You Read History Not With Your Eyes, But With Your Prejudices. This same text was from a famous, or this famous line is from an oration on Toussaint Louverture. So there are multiple layers of citing Toussaint throughout the journal. The article opens with a direct quotation of that line and its context, mentioning Toussaint and Wendell Phillips by name, and it makes the case for its application to biblical exegesis in early 20th century America. In her use of Martineau's text, Hopkins makes a similar case for the application of early abolitionist texts and their lessons about black heroism and their necessity for revolution to her early 20th century context. Her patchwork of narratives about race men, Martineau's Toussaint, Phillips' Toussaint, and her biography of Soga, is a textual model of her political vision to unite and uplift blacks in all parts of the globe. In June, the third installment of the journal was published alongside not only Soga's monthly column, but also a piece of the Filipino writer and nationalist Rizal. This same essay excerpted parts of Rizal's famous novel, Knowing the Time of It. So this is a biography of Rizal, and then there are sections from Bonitanga that are being reproduced in the three pages after this. By bringing together within the same issue a Filipino nationalist hero who died tragically at the hands of the Spanish, and a Haitian one, Hopkins facilitates another comparison between revolutionary heroes of color. In this way, she extends her pan-Africanist internationalist editorial policy to an interracial coalition of color, weaving in Filipinos into this of larger anti-racist project, and also giving Rizal a certain type of historical credibility by comparing him or giving him a textual precedent in Toussaint. Another change that Hopkins brought to this edition was the pacing of the book. The end of the first installment does not correspond to the end of a chapter or a built-in section break in the original book edition. Instead, the chapter ends with a cliffhanger, in the middle of a heated scene in which the white colonists suddenly realize that they are being watched by the island's black population. Scholars who had been through editions of 19th century novels had demonstrated that the deferral and piecemeal spacing of texts in serial magazine editions occasioned different temporalities of reading and different temporalities of engagement with the text from the unified book version. So in this case, the bound book came first and the serialization came later. Hopkins' spacing of the text is one indicator of her imprint on it. In some installments, this is more visible than in others. In fact, by tracing how much the cutting has been happening, we can see how involved Hopkins is. And as she stops making these changes, we see that she's being kind of gradually weaned out of the journal. So the first installment ends mid-chapter, the second begins in the middle of chapter one, but its ending corresponds to the end of chapter two. The third installment returns to the cliffhanger model and ends in the midst of a chapter four. The beginning and the end of the fourth installment correspond to the beginning and end of Martineau's chapter four. From then on, installments start corresponding to chapters meet. This lasts for 3 months, and then in September, after seven installments, the journal announces that the serialization of the Nine and the Hour will no longer continue. And there are reasons are given for this. But it is no accident that the serialization of Martineau's novel ended barely 2 months before Hopkins was fired from the magazine. And in those 2 months, just slowly being pushed out. The gradually waning role of Hopkins in the journal can be traced with a diminishing amount of work in the installments, which explains why the last four installments are just extracted chapters that don't necessarily have cliffhanger endings. By way of conclusion, I want to discuss this coinciding disappearance of the serial of The Hour and the Man and the expulsion of the editor, Colin Hopkins, from the Colored American. Just as the serialization of the novel began, the journal was saved from bankruptcy by a new owner, Fred Moore, new publisher, Fred Moore, and his white patron, an Englishman by the name of John Froude. Their vision for the future of the journal was very much at odds with Hopkins. Unlike Hopkins, they found little value in the cultivation of a literary magazine, finding more value in news reprinting and articles on business entrepreneurship. For them, that was the new direction for a race journal. They were displeased with Hopkins' constant references to lynchings and racial violence, her self-identification as a member of a prescribed race, and her engagement with contributors who critiqued US policy in the Philippines. The new management had decided to revamp the journal with or without Hopkins. The first step was to relocate the journal to New York. And this happened kind of in early summer of 1994. Before moving, in April, they reprimanded Hopkins. By June, Hopkins' name no longer appeared in the journal. And then in November, the Colored American magazine finally announced that Hopkins had left the magazine due to poor health. According to Hopkins, it was not her ill health, but her politics and her investment in literature that got her fired. In a now famous letter to Boston publisher Monroe Trotter, who I mentioned earlier, Hopkins explains, and I quote, "Little by little, Froude opened his views to me, and I found that he was curtailing my work from the broad field of international union and uplift for the blacks in all corners of the globe to the narrow confines of the question as affecting solely the Afro-American." End of quote. Her suspicions were confirmed in April, when Froude complained in a letter about her work to the publisher for a very insincere letter, and I'll quote a section of it. "Either Ms. Hopkins will follow our suggestion in this matter and put live matter in the magazine, eliminating anything which may create offense," because live matter cannot be offensive, "she will stop talking about wrongs and the prescribed race, or you must count me absolutely out. I will neither personally endorse nor help a business proposition which my common sense tells me is foredoomed to failure. Every person that I've spoken to on the subject is with me." And then in capitals, he writes, "It is Mr. Booker Washington's idea. If you people, therefore, want to get out the literary magazine with article on," again, capitals, "on the Filipino, I refuse to work 1 minute longer with you. This is my ultimatum, and I shall say no more on the subject." End of quote. In her letter to Trotter, Hopkins goes on to gloss Froude's main issues, explaining that a literary magazine applied to the articles of editor Soga, who was a cornerstone of her international policy, and whose literary generalities were shown in the, what she writes, "the gracefulness of his diction and the power of his thought on race matters. Prescribed race," she writes, "was a hit in my book on contending forces and my serial story Hagar's Daughter, both of which had aroused the ire of the White South," and both were about slavery, which is a similar topic as The Hour and the Man. But Mr. Garrison's article on industrial education and Professor Hamado's essay on Señor José Lisle, the Filipino martyr, were the arousals of our patron's ire and of Mr. Washington's wrath, because they not only offended the South, but also seemingly reflected upon President Roosevelt's Filipino policy. Quote, "So the fact that the novel serialization was about as soon as Hopkins was pushed out of the magazine is indicative of the shifting status of the literary and its uses of reprinting in this very important race journal. The incomplete reprint of The Hour and the Man in the archives of the Colored American magazine does stand as a memento to an editorial practice coming out of thrift the resulting innovation. For studies of the Victorian literature, this truncated edition opens up conversations about the rewilding of abolitionist Victorian novels in early 20th century African American print culture, and kind of gets us the questions of what is an African American edition of an earlier text. And it gets us more thinking about how do editors shape something called race literature in ways that we can that extend beyond the contributions and contributions or kind of edited series, but more about magazines, who's shaping what. And this basically was inspired by reading a lot of criticism on literary criticism, a lot of scholarship on the ways in which white editors were using black texts or manipulating them, curtailing black creativity. And then I found Hopkins doing this interesting stuff with The Hour of the Man. And I thought, oh wait, this is kind of a very different narrative. What I want to do more with is figure out what else is Hopkins doing. So it's not just, oh look, African American editors are publishing white authors, isn't that great? But because this is the only serial novel by somebody who's not her that's published here, this is kind of an interesting case. But I do want to, in the rest of this chapter, kind of think about reprinting not just kind of the unusual reprinting of white texts in black journals, but also kind of these practices of reprinting across the diaspora. So what it means for African Americans to be collecting poems from South Africa, and what it means for a Nigerian journal to be reprinting a novel from the US.
Thank you. Thanks for making this happen, Megan, and all you all, and all the other speakers. This is going to be pretty autobiographical, not all that scholarly at all. It's definitely untheorized. It's retrospective. Its best quality, I think, is that it's short. It has good pictures. It's actually somewhat confessional. But I met inside the Astrodome, and that's my material text right here. You're welcome to come see it afterwards. It's wonderful. I met it in fall 2002, which was the first semester of being in the PhD program at the University of Texas at Austin. And I needed that's about halfway through the semester, you need to start figuring out what you're going to write your seminar papers on. So I knew I was interested in stadiums. I'd written some about contemporary stadiums at that time, like the 1990s, like those retro ballparks. But I wanted something new. And I think somebody must have told me, well, you know, Houston Astrodome, there are these papers from one of the engineers over at this archive on campus. You should go check them out. So I did that. Went over, you know, you go into an archive, you get a bunch of colored paper with stamps on it and a handful of number two pencils that are all sharpened. So you don't have, and you go to the bathroom, so you don't have to leave for like, you know, four hour blocks. And I started pouring through these 31 archival boxes from this engineer, which included things like blueprints and illustrations and photographs and tons of newspaper clippings. What else? Like trade materials from like concrete companies, actual hand filled out calendars, like day by day calendars, like construction schedules. And eventually, I'm not sure when I got to it. It's in the 19th box. I don't know if it took that long, because that would be a really long time. But I finally got to inside the Astrodome, and instantly realized I hit some sort of pager. Show you some images in a second, and maybe I can convey that to you. This would not only be the kind of anchor for my first batch of papers, but it also would prove to be, I think, by far the most important source I've found to this point in my scholarly career. And I, you know, math, but many, many years later, I'm finally finishing a book that really flows out of this Souvenir program. Now, when Megan asked if I might be interested in doing something, I instantly this text came to mind, but it was followed by this sort of sense of panic, which is not irregular at all, at least for me. You know, I often have all these irrational fears about my career. But
welcome to the party.
Yeah. So that doesn't get any better.
No. Sorry.
You know, it made total sense because I've taught classes on material culture, sort of. I study the built environment for certain, and that's material culture writ large, right? I was an English major, and so I brought these kind of habits of close textual analysis into what now I guess I'm kind of a historical geographer / interdisciplinary, right? Built environment person. But you know, I use people's words to reconstruct historical landscapes. It's really important to me. But I'd never actually thought about this thing, this most important material text, as a material object. So I was, of course, like, I mean, you know, I hope this isn't true, that this vision of everything crumbling down once I actually did that, or coming in here and somebody pointing out something that would just ruin my argument that my book is built on, was kind of there. It's a little bit crazy, but if you do have that brilliant insight, please don't share it with me. But it's also been really productive to kind of reckon with some of the questions posed by the symposium, which, as I understand it, are, you know, how does the form of inside the Astrodome shape its meaning? How do I account for this in my scholarship? How has the place of this material text shifted over the course of my project? And I think it does. I can deal with those straightforward questions. Before getting to those, I want to give you a quick tour, so you can feel the love too, I hope. And the horror. It's a mix of love and horror, right? I mean, this is 1965 Houston. So the Houston Astrodome, the Houston Astrodome is the world's first completely enclosed stadium, opened in 1965. It was built to attract a Major League Baseball team because Houston was growing, you know, enormously after the war, on the back of petroleum and chemical industries. And it needed to be big league. And the way you got to be big league for a city is to have a Major League Baseball team in the 1960s, and before, and maybe since, but really the NFL has kind of overtaken baseball as a marker. Here's a view of Houston and where it's situated. This is downtown. This is Southwest, brand new freeway looping around the city. This is actually probably from 1968. But this was kind of the mode at the time, right? Your stadium's out by the suburbs. The really rich people in Houston live around here. Really poor people from Houston live around here. So get out to where the money is. The stadium was multifunctional. It could host all sorts of things. In addition to baseball, it had a roof. It had air conditioning. These can be good things in Houston. In the stadium's defense. I could stage football games, truck shows, the circus, Billy Graham revivals. And Billy Graham was one that called it, dubbed it the eighth wonder of the world, marking it as one of the great accomplishments of human history. And if you don't know, Billy Graham was like this really popular evangelist. It would pack places like the Houston Astrodome and older stadiums. So inside the Astrodome is this glossy souvenir program that accompanied its opening. As you can see from the cover, you probably can't quite read it down here, but it's 260 pages of stories, facts, figures, and illustrations on Houston's fabulous Astrodome, the most complete sports and stadium book in the world, right? So this book itself is like Marvel. It's a stadium, but it's also the greatest stadium book that's ever existed, and it's pretty thick. Some of the stories included are tales of its origin, right? There's a whole mythology built around it. This guy, Roy Huff Hines. If anybody's ever seen, what's that movie? Robert Altman's Brewster McCloud. If you ever heard of that,
it's basically, he's a main character. And now there are eight, right? So it situates it in this kind of historical arc of significance. It gives you details on its construction, and this is the first of like 10 pages of scaffolding and, holes in the ground, enormous holes in the ground. A seat for everyone, right? So these luxury suites, this is another marker of this book. There are lots of women posing with the setting, which is one of the crucial things that it does, and I'll kind of get to that in a second. You've got the luxury suites over here, which were basically invented at the Houston Astrodome. They're theme spaces. They often have these quite troubling kind of racialized themes. You've got six or seven different restaurants throughout. Introductions to the press with the freely floating heads. Miss Astro, right? Explosion of color in the seats. Celebration of its enormous scoreboard, which puts the roar of
shame.
And beer and liquor ads. And airline ads. And those are fun. So as an object in a text, I kind of thought about this as doing a number of things. First, it orients visitors to the stadium, framing the spaces they'll encounter there, and revealing these kind of hidden marvels behind the scenes where you wouldn't be able to go, like all the computerized stuff, the brain which runs everything. And so it essentially explicitly and implicitly teaches people how to read the space, right? What to think of what the stadium is and what the symbolic values are. Second, it's a souvenir. It's something you would take home. So you can compare it to other programs. And so here's another program when Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles in 1962, it devotes about 7 or 8 pages to the construction of the stadium and the people who made it possible, not 260, right? So the stadium itself, this object amplifies the original form. It functions as this kind of authenticating object for visitors to possess and materialize their experience within the stadium. And I think also for me, it was an authenticating object, knowing that this was something that had been there when it was opened, that this was something owned by one of the engineers, that had been read by people sitting in those padded seats. So in a kind of fanboy way, it kind of made this kind of quick connection to space, and maybe made me more comfortable writing about it, which could be dangerous. And thirdly, the program advertises and advises a certain way of living for the Houstonian American living in 1965. I mean, in this sense, while it's kind of partly, it lends something to a tradition of a program, a stadium program, it's actually a lifestyle manual in a lot of ways. Which is both more and less ridiculous than it sounds. Here are a few images from the program, and I can put together 30 slides of this sort of stuff. Inside the Astrodome invites individuals into a community of post-war and Cold War modernity that celebrated the new and technological, but it defined the community in very certain ways that were aligned along class, gender, race, sexual, kind of local identity, national identity. These various lines. And it occurs, I think, crucially in the midst of challenges to this kind of post-war, white, middle class, kind of heteronormative world, right? So it kind of, the stadium itself is a sort of escape pod from some of the social change, destabilizing social changes going on around it, or things that would have been perceived and for me, this final function of the program is a manual for modern living proved to be the most valuable. That's why I'm sitting here talking about it as the most important source I've encountered. I instantly saw within it a set of kind of stark and shameless claims about what a stadium should be and what to that point it had not been. Stadiums had once been grimy, rambunctious, masculine, racially mixed, and cross-class expressions of urban diversity and unpredictability.
in the kind of iconic stadium in that vein is Ebbets Field in central Brooklyn. Here's a shot from the bleachers. These have been, you know, genuinely public spaces where people experienced a version of city life that by 1965 had become anathema to the white middle class, at least most of them. For them, the Astrodome was what this stadium, should be, and by extension, what public space should be. Inside the Astrodome made this explicit to the reader in 1965, and also to me in 2002. So, to some degree. This is how the materiality of inside the Astrodome has mattered in my scholarship. It consolidated all these ideas about modernist stadium and post-war American life in one place. It was a sort of a Rosetta Stone that revealed to me the cultural work that the stadium did across the country in the 1960s as a wave of these new modernist stadiums were built from New York to Los Angeles. The bald and shameless hucksterism of the program trained me to see kind of fainter traces and strains of this worldview in other sources that were, you know, discrete sources, newspaper articles here, or some illustration here, or a blueprint here. Or even in the actual spaces of the stadiums themselves that I had visited. So it was this great gift whose kind of focused intensity helped me theorize the stadium and its cultures and city after city. But that coherence, the fact that all these stories and images are bound together in a single material object is also kind of dangerous, right? I think in many ways the text is too coherent, its meanings are too consolidated and tidy. And so in retrospect, it worked as a magnet for all these kind of strains that I then saw out here, you know, that then became my sources, and that then shaped the way the arguments I was making and elided some of the kind of messier possibilities of experiencing and understanding space itself. Maybe I projected the Astrodome onto other stadiums in very different social, political, economic settings. Queens, St. Louis, in San Francisco, in Pittsburgh. So, you know, I think in truth I owe most of my scholarship to this source in some way. It's back there. The traces of all these the traces of the ideas here have kind of penetrated so much of what I've written about the stadium and also the post-war city. But at the same time, I've been trying to like untangle myself from this tidy precision ever since. Complicating its argument in my own, trying to figure out other ways that people thought about the stadiums in the city over this period. So I've never really thought about that. And only now that I'm being asked to consider the materiality of the text did it occur to me how crucial the materiality of it actually was way back then. If all these ideas had not been stitched together in a single volume, I might not be making these arguments about stadium that I am today, but at the same time, I might not actually be making arguments about the stadium at all. So, thank you.
So, hello, I'm Kim. I'm really cool. I came all the way from California just for this.
Oh, my God.
No, I'm just kidding. Sort of gotcha. Serendipitously already on the East Coast, and it just so happened that Dan asked me to fill in the slot and talk about Zines. So I'm here, and I really appreciate being for this talk today about Zines. And it's sort of in the time span that I had to literally cut and paste, no pun intended, this presentation together. So to kind of start at the beginning, I started doing zines in about 1987. And like many of us, we're sort of deviant little suburban punk kids. So where can I have this outlet? So zines were kind of the ways that we got into that. And subsequently now, I've turned that into teaching other kids how to be little print disruptors. And then sort of spiraling into a career of a deviant librarian and now developing collections.
collections with zines, so you can see my slope of my curve, how it's kind of gone. But interestingly enough, why zines and why that? And quickly, I've always felt that print has a lot of power, and especially zines have that singular power, print power. And I'll talk about that in a minute, but that's actually one of my, a send of one of my zines there in the middle. Just to quickly put this out there, does anyone not know what a zine is? And you don't have to raise your hand or anything to talk about it, but it's sort of interesting how many people, I don't really know what a zine or zine is. So, yeah, say zine, not zine, because that's just wrong. So, zines are sort of literally just that. They are essentially the sort of deviant provocateurs of the print world. And I say that because they scrub a lot of notions about censorship and censors, editors, and compositional codes for things, like one might have in sort of a mass media publishing, the publishing world. But to be fair, zines are really, they have a common denominator with a lot of printed matter, in fact, and that is that they are created with the conscious and unconscious behavior to really be a document. And to become a document in this case, what I'm kind of referring to as an archive, however ephemeral that they actually might be. And so in 2008, I made this zine capsule, and I got this itch about preservation. I was working in the library at the time when everyone seemed to be digitizing and everything, and it was slowly becoming this thing. And so I started thinking about the DIY, the do-it-yourself aspects about zines, and the huge impact they have made just sort of in academia. But I wanted to have this conversation between, because I felt that it was important as a zine creator and zine libraries, because I was working in a library, and how can we keep this dialogue going about zine preservation, but also as a person making zines themselves, well, why can't we collect and sort of keep them for ourselves? So it's like everyone can do this. I wanted to find some basically some cohesive. And really introduced that idea of zines as social cultural documents. But there's sort of an interesting meta that's going on with this because, so it's zine people collecting, preserving zines. So I made a zine about preserving zines that's going to be in print form being preserved. So it's kind of weird meta about this. But the tech in this is really out of date. So if you find this online, you download it, you're like, wow, that's like, no one uses that. Software anymore, but the, interestingly enough, the paper portion of it is still very current, ironically. But the idea of zines being preserved in an institutional setting has very mixed messages for the actual zine community. On the flip side, it's opened a lot of communications about with the community and the scholarly community as well, who in many ways are working towards sort of a symbiotic relationship to promote zines as a valid. One of the librarians that I asked to be involved in Dean Council, who's awesome, Jenna Friedman at Barnard College in New York, in Brooklyn, I asked her, well, can you just write a little snippet about why you started collecting zines in Barnard and why it's important? And these were the three most important reasons for her, and they have to do with actual culture. And incidentally, they collect two copies at Barnard, one for preservation and one for access, which I'll talk about later. So her reasons were very straightforward. Preservation of the thinking and artifacts of the movement, okay? Providing access to publications that reflect this different aspect of society than the norm, so it's sort of marginalized. And then an invaluable educational tool teaching people that it is easy and rewarding to create media, not just consume it. So this has been very, that's why I highlighted it, this is very important, and this is sort of one of the monikers of the zine community, is talking about media, not just as consumption, but as a process, and the making of things, and I'm gonna refer to that later. It's a sort of thinking process about zines and the zines community. Just to give you a little brief history about zines. So these are fanzines, and there's arguments about how, where zines actually sort of come from. So Thomas Paine and Princeton and stuff like that. But really the sort of fanzine and then sort of the shortened version of zines that we know, it comes from the beginning of the 1920s through about the 50s, the golden age of science fiction, which were basically realized science in literary forms. These were. But they're important for a few reasons, in that they were fan-based, amateur writers coming together and collecting their voices. And they were emerging. They were emerging writers at the time who went on to become, you know, the Ray Bradbury's at that time. But they started out in these fanzines in this genre. But the content was really reader-driven. It was inspired by the people who were reading them. But also the mimeograph. So the mimeograph really revolutionized reproduction for these, and it made the distribution and sort of then drove the content to be really prolific and sort of get out there. So that's sort of one of the baselines for the zine movement there. So we're going to sort of jump a little bit forward. This is where a lot of people say, oh, zines are punk. Zines are punk. And so 1970s, the fanzine really flourished at that time. In UK, New York, Los Angeles. Punk really reclaimed this notion of fan-driven publications, but also the onset of new printing capabilities and the Xerox machine. So zines were still being sort of printed, but the Xerox machine made it really cheap and easy to do this. Like you could sort of basically cut it up in your kitchen and go print it and hand it out. This is really, again, like I said, where most people's ideas about the formation of zines kind of come from. Punk as a reflection of the DIY counterculture movement and subversive ideas of the medium. Again, there was it was a lot less expensive to make. The paper, a lot of it was really cheap, cheaply printed on newsprint, which I know is a preservation right there, but that sort of expresses an idea of a notion of commodity. But honestly, in my opinion, the idea of zines as critical propaganda really comes from people's revolutionary movements of the 1960s, where similar technologies were used, so mimeograph and printing. And then distribution, we have an example here, Black Panther pamphlets, La Raza Unida, which was a political party of people that identified as Chicanos at the time in the 1960s, very politically charged group. And then a pamphlet from the anarchist group, whatever at the time. So I think, though, that this is where zines, both in content, both briefly and beyond, you know, these were sort of ephemeral items, they were sort of throwaway items. But this material inside and the content was really insurrectionary, and it outlined entire political platforms for many of these radical groups in the 1960s. And nowhere else would you get to read about these kind of voices at the time, because at the time, you know, a local newspaper, you know, maybe not in sort of bigger metropolitans, wasn't going to feature an article on the class Black people of America, you're just not going to see them anywhere else. And so these sort of pamphlets and how they were distributed really sort of says something about sort of propaganda as commodity, propaganda as historical records, social documents at the time. So visually, you can kind of see what's happening. I mean, punk really took a nod from sort of the design. If you look at a lot of art at the time in the 60s, it really was emulated in the 70s with some of these fanzines. These are some of the more popular ones, two from Los Angeles and then one from New York City. Because the ideas presented in this, the words were seen as weapons, similar, but the content actually was less about the politics of ideology and race and classes of people. It took on the spirit of nonconformity and subversiveness in music and culture, but not so much as political platforms taking from the sort of vision taken from the 1960s, but not so much in content-wise, a sort of return to sort of fandom and to music and culture at the time. However, nonconformist it was at the time, but kind of fun to pull stuff through anyways. So now we're getting to sort of the a little bit the meat of this, even more archivy. And so then now that you know a little bit about things as history, what then would constitute a zine as an actual record? So we have this sort of nice textbook definition, one of them. There's a lot out there of definitions of what a record actually is. But if we look at it from a cultural preservation stance, there's a lot of definitions out there, official definitions. This one in particular is taken from the Society of American Archivists. Well, what I like about it is it says that this last part, it says that recorded that, and that is used as an extension of human memory or to demonstrate accountability. And I think that really rings true in a lot of these communities that we know today. Another, which is sort of interesting, another record suggests that records go on beyond just paper, it's audio and digital, et cetera, too. So you have to address that last 2 years. So, under all these assumed definitions, then, zines fall into that category, even with these official terminologies, which sort of zines fall outside being official. Even in archival theory, there includes a lot of wiggle room about definitions of things. And zines have definitely challenged the archive's vernacular, not only in terms of their function, but their characteristics. I mean, you can see here, there's a lot of things going on. This is just one example. By the inclusion of other materials with their formats. They're hard to catalog. I don't know if anyone here has ever cataloged a zine. No author, no issue, you know, the serial run, things like that. And then Library of Congress subject headings, like really don't get me started on from the you know, which is why a lot of libraries that are collecting zines don't even use LC, which I think is very interesting and cool. So what does then mean, because this is one of these terms that gets thrown around a lot, what does it mean to define an archived record? And I kind of sort of pieced together one because really this used to describe a sort of digital aspect. But I like this, it's really pertaining to an authority on a particular topic, aggregated primary sources, having demonstrated unique and managed control over. So this would sort of be like, this is what I saw a lot, would be like a database of record, or perhaps an official, so this university, the records of an official office would be the archive of record for the university, for administrative decisions. So why would you think zines would fall into this sort of definition of archive of record? Well, honestly, you know, zines aren't going to be rewritten in digital terms. They are read-only. You cannot revise. So a lot of the texts we talk about this morning is being written and revised. That's not going to happen with zines. These records are their original content format, having original format and original content. So this, in terms of a strictly literal definition, fits the scope of zines. But I'm kind of looking at them as a body of an archive, as a conceptual idea to this. And I want to mention one other thing talking about archives. In sort of the world of when you go to library school, if you don't quote Jacques Derrida, you know, so the last I heard, one faculty at the University of California, Irvine, argued that there is no political power without control of the archive, if not memory. Effective democratization can be measured by this essential criterion. The participation in and access to the archive, its constitution, and its interpretation. So I'm kind of just let you stew on that for a minute. because thinking about this, herein lies a problem, rather an argument. So another quote up here, it's sort of transgressive to say then that seems creatively and conceptually are radical in that notion of archive of record for a narrative. And so I'm kind of stretching this definition a little bit, only because ironically, zines zines and their creators are typically anti-authoritarian in general. And then sort of stating the obvious to observe, again, sort of reading this quote, that no archive is an authoritative source for grasping a record of the past. And I'm sort of emulating meaning here. We know from post-colonial studies in which the archive is a demonstratively an artifact of colonial framework. And thank you, Sarah, for talking about that this morning. That the story of any archive tells is provisional and partial. To be really clear, archival colonialism is taken from, so I'm talking about this in terms of anthropology lens. For example, archives acting as a means to gather information and bolstering political power, regardless of geographic control. And that was sort of mentioned this morning more eloquently, but I think it's a concept that just describes the sentiment in contemporary archives, especially towards marginalized communities. So essentially, what others and like Mimi are saying, who donated a sort of a massive collection of people of color zines to Warner, is saying that in order to decolonialize our primary sources, we need to consider not just studying the object or the thing, but the making of them and what they represent. So I'm gonna talk about this in terms of a few aggregated sources that I think really exemplify the idea of archives as records and sort of this whole decolonial idea of that and what they manifest and how to that those embody their value, not just consuming them as sort of these sort of artifacts or as media. So one of the best examples of this and sort of topically that has been really collected in the last few years have been zines, and partially because there were a lot of zines that were produced at this time of the riot girl movement that started about early 80s to mid 80s. And it was really pivotal to a generation of young women who challenged the landscape of gender identity at the time and sort of was a reaction to the patriarchy and the punk movement. So again, it was a response to misogyny and sort of the explosiveness in punk rock mainly. But also I think it expanded to include issues affecting women like body image, rape culture, self-care, particularly DIY women's hair, and essentially things that, frankly, the majority of punk music really just was not addressing at the time. So these are a few examples of themes that were remained at the time. The one on the left particularly had a manifesto, and sort of this is where this term, the girl power term, Bikini Kill Zine, and they wrote about the Riot Girl Manifesto and their zine as well. Here are just a few more examples. You can see topically what's going on here. But basically, the Riot Girl Manifesto was a brief, the personal and political, and it really emulated the third wave of feminist movement. So if you think about the waves of feminist movements, the first wave being the suffragist movement, and secondly being sort of the women's liberation movement of the 50s and 60s. The third wave was sort of really playing at this time. And these zines are, again, seen as social records, and their narratives are the primary sources. It's my opinion, if it was not for the creation of these zines, there may or may not have been any way to cement or capture the vernacular of the third wave movement. It was a way to empower people to put their narrative and their personal political narratives into print media and sort of record that at the time. They were really, zines for this sort of community was really a vehicle to document the manifesto of Riot Girl, and in turn, this became the social records for the third wave. But they also acted as a timeline and a development for the third wave, how the movement was chronicled, how it developed, and how it transformed and changed, and frankly, honestly, became a critique of itself, the biggest critique being that this sort of Riot Girl movement was very exclusive to just white privilege and cisgendered women. So there was a lot of things that sort of came out of that that formed in a dialogue now that's sort of happening making and feminism too. So a great example of this, of how a rubber collection has sort of been aggregated together, aggregated sources together. This is the book actually that was published from the collection, which includes not only zines, but a lot of other ephemera and audio and things like that at the Fales Library in New York University. And so this presents a body of an archive as subject and as also as feminist identity. And I think it's significant because it really keeps together the Rye Girl as a collection, and it represents the archive of record for the Rye Girl movement. So that's just sort of one example. This is sort of not really a housed collection necessarily, but I think it's something important that a lot of people don't really know about in terms of a sort of body of things that were being published at the time and really poignant, critical for themes, but also for documenting an event and sort of a tragedy that happened. This is a narrative of post-Katrina, mostly post-Katrina zines, and there was hundreds of zines that came out post-Katrina, particularly in the area. And so not only did this sort of chronicle what was happening, and recorded the current events of the time, but it really sort of looking at a snapshot. And so this is a quote from Shelley Jackson, who does a zine, a few zines, but one of them was called Chainburger, about the bike movement in New Orleans. And I won't read that quote, because I have another one that I think really speaks to this idea of what I'm going to talk about next. She says, to study the individual and local narratives in these written artifacts is to privilege the subject perspective first, and to relate it to collective and social processes second. This is where identity really points to authenticity. And so this is a big thing in archives theory. There's a lot of discussion about what makes a record authentic, and I'm sure a lot of people have addressed this. It's a lot of it has to do with authority, validation. When we look at original production of things like paper, is it handwritten? Were the creator source materials? But I think it's important to know that a narrative defined in the scope of this is authenticity. So. These were eliciting a community where their voices were not being represented anywhere else at the time. So if you sort of look back in time and think about Katrina, what was being recorded in the media, which was sort of fear, a lot of voices that weren't being represented of the community. And so thus there was a response in the area to create scenes of people's experiences. And currently, what's going on still in the community, which is still very much present as far as people still struggling to even have places to live, sort of this many years later. Lastly, sort of often challenged, this is sort of often challenging, the QZAP, which is the Queer Zine Archive Project, based out of Milwaukee. We often hear about archive record in terms of digital archives. Again, like I was saying, a database of record. For example, that could be an institutional repository with theses and dissertations or administrative metadata. But I think authenticity is often challenged with digital objects, and it's really a sort of point of contention in the archives world, whether you have physical or digital archives. But I think they're really trying to archives are working really hard to maintain a general representation of the holdings through the preservation of records and maintaining the intent of the creator. And this is a really great example of an aggregated sources of queer zines, that a lot of them have really high-end political content, but that they're fully accessible online through their scans in a way, unsearchable in a way, that people not having sort of accessibility issue, or having accessibility issues, can search and can look through this sort of database of record that represents the queer community in particular. And so, really, it's my opinion that with this in mind, the fact still remains that digital preservation is really pointless without access. And what I think is really important to note that digitization of such zines, in this case, is really driving the community, the zine community, and the scholarly community, to think about posterity, impact, and social empowerment through preservation. But it's also driving scholarship to recognize the importance of zines and with their intended mechanism, so the process we were talking about earlier about thinking, which is essentially a radical zine community authoritative source. So, kind of winding down here, what does this really mean for zines then? Print in the context of community is really critical. There's a great zine librarian, her name is Allison Pipe-Meyer, who talks a lot about embodied communities, and sort of this is coming from an activist slant. And this is important for a number of reasons, including identity, representation, what is included in an embodied community, authentic voice, and the physicality of zines, the physicality of a community. It's really about having a connection to a physical community of living people that congregate and shape discourse for and about in different issues that are important, including feminism, and this is sort of in the zine vernacular, race, environmental activism, and gender. This is really essential for an archive to consider. And so this kind of translates into the process of keeping narratives together. And this is sort of why I show these examples. Because zines, processing zines as collections is really important because I think that I think it helps them to identify their, to validate them for their authenticity, but I also think that it keeps the terminology together in order to identify them. Like I was saying earlier, a lot of times certain subject headings do not really represent zine discourse. It's sort of faded in the background, but when I was at San Diego State University working on special collections, there was, they have a pretty massive zine archive, and they are not using Library Congress subject headings or tagging with keywords that actually come out of the zine. So they're having a student, it's a student-led project, they're having the students sort of go through and tag each record in a sort of fine way that really represent the language of what the creators are trying to represent here. So here's the thing about zines, and that is zines were meant to be transmitted, exchanged, to take on another ownership, for someone else to feel their empowerment, because if they weren't, they would be a diary. So in that way, just sort of like an official memo from a university president's office or a press release, it is meant to be read and distributed, thinking in terms of archives of record. You know, if you think about a lot of personal correspondence between, say, a writer or something that exists in an archive, do you think that the original creator thought about another scholar reading the content to find out about their methodology? It's really hard to know that. So zines are in the present, and they hold as much content authority as administrative document, in my opinion. And the materiality of the format connects the production with the community and for the creator. It's a really necessary balance of intimacy and between them and the audience, and because of the nature of zines, this really builds the integrity of the historical authenticity that drives an archive to fulfill the purpose of exposing and preserving these narratives. So zines as an embodied archive, they embody the paper that they represent as much as the community of creators, readers, and scholars that ingest their images in the text. And I think it's important to note that the object, the artifactual quality of a zine has a lot more to do with sustaining and engaging a community, as much as it does making sure that they stay around with us for a while and inspiring people to keep creating them. So, that. Thank you very much.
I'll just have a couple of closing remarks, not more than 5 or 10 minutes, and we'll be out of here in a half hour or so. So once again, I'm going to turn it over to student facilitators, Liv and Cam. Jack in the back has asked me to ask you to speak up so that, particularly those of you who are in the front, that we actually get your questions as well as our panelists' brilliant response to them on the record for later on. So with that, I'll turn it over to you guys.
Yeah, so my first question, Kim, is for you about how zines have changed since the 60s, 70s, when they're getting printed, to now, and if how the medium has changed. Are they still mostly being printed in pamphlets, or are zine creators looking to social media to get their word out? Because, you know, like you said, it speaks mostly to a anti-norm ideas, and it could be gotten out through the Facebooks, Twitters, but that's not the same as having a pamphlet with the illustration and the color in your hand.
Right. So, when I was doing zine workshops, a lot of people, probably about 10 years ago, were asking, oh, are blogs going to replace zines? And my response to that was, actually, what the internet has done for zines has made it easier for people to acquire them, because at the time, in the 80s, you had to go to a bookstore or a book show or another sort of politically congregated event to acquire them. Sometimes, like, do you remember Tower Records? I mean, yeah. Tower Records used to have zines. So you could get them there, but I think the internet has said has really made it easier for the discourse to happen online for people to acquire them. As far as content is concerned, I've seen a wave of, interestingly enough, I've seen a wave of content change depending on the political climate of the time. Because in the 80s, it was all about sort of anti-review. I mean, the issues, a lot of the issues are the same. But I'm seeing sort of a change throughout time as far as the content is concerned. Because definitely in the 80s and 90s, it was very feminist charged. And it was 80% women. And that's sort of the balance of the shift with that, because it used to be a lot more. So there's a gender issue happening there. But now I see a lot of, because the way technology is sort of enhanced things, there's a lot of very nicely printed zines coming out. Does that make them as good just because they were done in Photoshop? That's sort of a debate, rather than sort of, you know, I sit there meticulously and cut things out and use a typewriter, you know, seriously. Does that make mine sort of fit that definition of zine rather than someone who went to a printer and had that? That's hard to say. I think really the key is what you just said, the materiality of the paper itself is still being continued to be done. And the distribution, like I said, these are meant to be sort of exchanged and given a second ownership to someone else, whether it's a scholarship or someone else having them to pay for whatever.
When you said the internet has facilitated distribution. I'm not sure I understand you, particularly because of the question you opened, the question in my mind. From the little I know about zines, I think of it as a physical object,
yeah.
Not as a blog or something
right.
On the internet, not as if it doesn't have a digital presence.
Right.
Are you saying that it does?
I'm saying the way to acquire them has changed. So there's this term called a distro. And a distro was a single or many people coming together, and they basically set up a shop. And now sort of Etsy has kind of replaced that a little bit. But there still are zine distros out there where you could go browse their catalog of items, type in a term, I would like to read about sort of queer anarchist zines, and we'll all these zines to have that content and they describe them as such, and then order them online. So what I'm saying
is getting a physical object,
but I mean, I've ordered zines in Palestine. You know, I've been able to acquire zines from all over the world, which you would have to send away, put your money, you know, in the
same way that the internet has
you know, or look in the back of a book magazine, like Maximum Rock. To mention this, but you could look in the back of Maximum Rock and Roll at Backsheet 5. Someone would have their P.O. box address, and you would write to them, send their money, and get your team back. Yeah, so that's kind of changed the way the commodity of them has changed.
But that internet has affected everything.
It's just promotion. I mean, it's marketability and sort of the visibility of them.
A physical object and not a digital
absolutely
object.
You know, just cross out e-zine in your like vocabulary because that's just
no right thought. Yeah.
But does that affect the intimacy of it? It seemed to me a lot of this was around intimacy and community and not something you're being intimate with somebody else.
But doesn't that speak to like a sort of amazing discourse of how we are able to sort of think about exchange and expand your idea of what community is? But there are still zine fests happening. In fact, probably this year, I see more listings for zine fests or festivals, and you're able to find out about them and they're promoted. I mean, I was just in LA a couple weeks ago for and it just, we're talking hundreds and hundreds of people kind of coming together. So what it does is sort of sets a paradigm. Like, here's the event, can you come together and do that? So I still think that there is a very, what I was talking about, physical
visibility that happens
when you know about it, when you come together,
sort of
in exchange in that way. I still, it's very much still
prevalent. Lisa, and then Lev, and then Marina,
so my question's from Marina, but a side note, I just went to a zine fest in Milwaukee not long ago. It's okay. Anyways, but my question's for Marina because, sorry to get off the same topic momentarily, no, but I really, I wanted to ask you about, I have two questions, I'm just going to ask. I wanted to ask you why autobiography and biography in particular, seem to play such an important role as a genre in the American Colored Magazine, and in the way in which, oh my god, all the names just escaped me. In the way in which Hopkins?
The editor, yeah.
Yes, the editor was curating and serializing, right, the Marnot work. So why does biography become this, if I understood you correctly, mm-hmm. biography was this dominant genre in this magazine, why has it become so like politically, why does it have such political cachet for her?
Well, in some ways it's because the journal is doing the alternative pedagogy that schools should be doing. So there's a fear that, especially the northern readers might be schools that don't have that kind of education. It's a remedial education of Black history. And because this is still a period when the literary biography is seen very much as literary, so there is a kind of bellwether aspect to writing a beautiful biographical essay that will have equal literary weight as a poem, for example. And also, it's with biographies, it can become almost a serial, right? You can do and then every month fill that in. And for any kind of, a lot of the journals I work on, I keep thinking about the relationship between anti-racist journals and zines, because they never have enough subscribers, they depend on, but because they're not supposed to be mainstream in the same way, they're always challenged with status quo, and they're also supposed to be circulated, not just read by one person. So the problem with that is, one of the reasons I think why she reprints Harriet Martineau is she needs to fill out she needs something to replace her own serial novels, but I don't think she's just putting in anything there, right? So that's kind of so another the biographies themselves are kind of serial filler, but also doing this remedial editing.
Did you want to follow up to that?
No.
Okay, so we'll come back to you after we do Lev and Marina.
My question is also for Marina. So I was interested in, we were discussing Hopkins modernizing the work in prose, but you know, capitalizing and giving it greater political power. And I'm interested in this shifting status of racial markers, because I feel like that's also happening today. I'm a big fan of hip-hop music, and you know, the N-word, you know, how it has racial racist roots. But that hard R has kind of dropped in music now, and it's taken on this new meaning, which I think extends a little bit beyond race. Because you know, groups of white friends in my community, you know, for instance, will use it. And it's, in one way, I really appreciate how it's kind of transcended its racialized roots and is now stands for something more like brotherhood and commonalities. But at the same time, it's hard not to acknowledge the fact that it, you know, is from the heart of art. So, the question is, is race literature for you more significant, whether positively or negatively significant, for the celebration and documentation of history or the perpetuation of difference?
That's an interesting question. And I'm not sure that perpetuation of difference is a bad thing, per se, because perpetuation of difference is not to be necessarily about to be like a segregation of canons. And I think the ways in which she uses the term color in the journal, especially around 1903, when she decides to make this an internationally focused journal, and so that's basically one of the reasons why she's fired is she writes about the Philippines in a journal that this white patron wants to be specifically African American. So I think seeing that moment where one racial term, colored, becomes a racial keyword, which then changes its meanings across time and space, mm-hmm. context, that kind of opens up ways of thinking about a race, and I use the term race literature as a way of thinking about how do we think of an African American literature that's trying to think about its relationship to other minority literatures, other so-called colored literatures, right? And that's how race literature becomes something that's African American literature, but in excess of it too, or at least trying to think of it that way.
Yeah, and if I just follow up with it, this is something I think that I'm not expecting an answer. So my question is, you know, you said perpetuating difference isn't necessarily bad. And I think kind of we define the world through difference. You know, the way we understand something as being something is as not being another thing. And as long as we define the world this way, like, it seems impossible in my mind that we'll ever reach any sort of like equality among all people, because there will always be you're not what I am. You know?
Well, this is what I'm pointing to is the strategic essentialism, almost before Spivak talks about strategic essentialism. The fact that the term around which the difference is being defined is changing itself and can encompass more and more people, and then the fact that, you know, what I'm also trying to point out is that African American literature, if we understand it in terms of editing practices too, also be what an African American editor does to a text from a white triangle right within the welding of the African American literature. So I don't know if that necessarily answers your larger question about particularity and difference, but
there's also different equality again.
Yeah, difference is important because inevitably if you don't have difference, then we might all be subsumed by one dominant identity. It's important for minority groups to be recognized as different to preserve their heritage.
Can we just follow up on any follow-up questions?
No, I have one.
Well, related question for Ben. Are there any black faces in that 1965 Astrodome brochure?
Players.
Yeah. Is that it? That's all.
Yeah, which I think that's also an interesting historical, I don't know if it's an accident or not, but I showed the image of that field. The owner of the Dodgers starts looking for a new stadium a couple months after the season ends, in which Jackie Robinson breaks the color line in Brooklyn, and Central Brooklyn is starting to be ghettoized. I think there's there's an irony, or there's something kind of more sinister about increasingly black faces filling the stadium floor, but then are re-racializing it with the people around them.
Can I ask Ben
a
question?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Do you know anything about the team involved in creating the book and the process of its production?
Not really. I mean, I know who made it. Uh-huh. The Houston Sports Association made it. They operated the Astrodome. They technically owned the Astros. They made a bunch of the stuff. It was an outfit. It was that guy I showed, the man with his idea lifting the top off the club. it was kind of his fiefdom to a certain degree, so I know a lot about him. The actual, more like the production details, you know, like the Astros themselves don't know. So I can't get rights to these images.
But
well,
you don't know who wrote the copy or who
had it. There are a couple bylines in it,
There's one from a woman who's a fashion editor for the Post. But it's like one or two. And there's, you know, the format is, there's a series of kind of official men letters at the start, right? LBJ has like a presidential letterhead celebrating the endeavor of Houston in America. And the Chamber of Commerce has one, you know, and all the different political figures have one. So there is specific authorship sprinkled in there. So, sorry?
Lily?
I didn't see anyone.
Lori has a burning question.
The image that you showed with the three images, I'm pushing on you to answer something that you sort of said, well, we can talk about women in this later, and we never quite got to that.
Yep.
But that image with the family in front of the stadium, the guy is in a black suit, and the little kid and woman have the colors of the stadium in their clothes. Mm-hmm. It seemed very deliberate, and I wondered how women are represented throughout this document, and if you make something of that.
Oh, yeah. Read the book. I mean, they're like, yeah, they're civilizing ornaments, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they mark the space as safe for middle class consumption.
They're color coded because
it's yeah. Well, I mean, they're ornaments. There's this great photo I remember from the Houston Chronicle where they bring in the people from the John Power School. John Power School, basically, they like trained flight attendants to be kind of civil and have the proper manners, right? And they bring them in to train. I did not show you the fabulous pictures of the SpaceX, who have their like Jetsons outfits on like gold lamé and all this stuff. But there's this great picture of them kind of getting civilized within the kind of one of the luxury spaces in the stadium, the like lower levels. And it's like really clear that it's even more so. There's of them like sitting in the world's longest dugouts and riding the escalators, like these signifiers of kind of, you know, the symbolic excellence of the stadium is marked with the, like the way I think of it, the Philip DeLory book, Indians in Unexpected Places, right? It's women in unexpected places, and they kind of mark themselves as exceptional within the space itself. So the use of women is quite consciously linked to class reorientation and racial
comparability. There's a bunch of hands, and I want to make sure we have time for everybody. So we're going to go Marina, Anita, Cam, Elizabeth, and Marilyn. This is the order I saw your hands in.
Marina's already answered, but Elizabeth.
Okay, I'll make a note of that.
So I was struck by how you move between the ephemeral and the monumental and the virtual, and I was wondering, so I saw that there's projects that people are trying to collect them. But is there any, do people who are writing the zines, do they build like a citation network where like this zine is inspired by this other tradition or things like the Palestine Project, right? Some other zines that I found in German Palestine, blah, blah, blah. How much of there is this desire to kind of almost like record, even in the ephemeral, the fact that this belongs to a longer history and is citing, I think, where girls are
chronological and political movement for that. A lot of younger, now 20-something, the riot girl movement is like sort of period of time, it's like 40-plus the age group. So a lot of the younger, even sort of daughters or other family members of that age are sort of responding to that, of perhaps their role model, which could have been someone who was involved in that movement. So there are nods to that, but it's changed a lot. No longer young white women. It's now recontextualized to young black girls or trans identified communities. And so, in that way, it's been almost claimed again, which I find really awesome. So, yes, there are knots set out. There are knots of sort of that publishing of music.
Citation-wise, like literal citations,
not literal, but I'm thinking about how
there might be modes of kind of trying to do this recording work in the even in the ephemeral, right? That we just so that there's the
recording industry.
Yeah, absolutely.
Kind of like, oh, this is when
sort of in the current movement, but also fascinatingly in sort of the aesthetics too. There's this whole cut and paste style that started to happen in, I would say, about the 80s and 90s, where you'd have a background and the text was cut out and pasted over that, so you'd have this composition. That definitely used to be that sort of continuing. And again, using these sort of animal typewriters. Workshops, younger folks are just drawn to the typewriter because for them it's a visceral experience of sort of typing and connecting to this machine. You know, for them it's quite empowering. So, you know, to sort of think about mistakes, you know, you're going to make mistakes on the typewriter, so how that sort of plays into the creation of them and being captured in the scenes as well.
So,
This has never happened. I do not have a problem keeping the two of you. Can you confirm that for the people there? Yes, thank you.
So my question, Ben, is for you. So do we see, I'm from Texas, so I'm familiar with large football stadiums. So I'm curious about this. How much was the actual team talked about in that? Or was it an advertisement? And then second part, kind of different, is looking at more big stadiums. I don't know if you've looked at the new Dallas Cowboys Stadium, as, again, excessive in every way, but are they printing massive, I mean, in the scheme of things, books, advertising it, and selling those?
Yeah.
Probably
for
more than a dollar.
Well, yeah. I lost the first part.
Sports teams.
They definitely take a back seat. There's way better. Probably the
very
younger.
There's a Facebook.
And alongside, you know, the rodeo, Billy Graham, and circus, and all this other stuff. The Astrodome is very much about the Astrodome. It's not about the Astros. At least for a while. I've seen some newer programs. I've never seen a program like this, even the subsequent ones of Astrodome, although they're not, they still pick up, they still celebrate, and they still work as a kind of deciphering ring for the space in a way. They're more explicit about the kind of ideological meaning of the space than other ones I've seen. One interesting thing I've seen about the Texas AT&T Stadium is an art exhibit book, because Jerry Jones's wife is really into art, and so they bring in all these high-end artists, and it's basically a museum, right? So it kind of extends, it builds on the Astrodome, kind of turning this, like, this guy, Tex Schramm, who was the head of the Cowboys, said at the Astrodome, you know, they get it. Pretty soon we're all going to be eating lobster with, tuxedoed waiters. That's what the stadium needs to be. And Texas Stadium, our first Texas Stadium was a version of that with its own luxury suites, and I think AT&T is another expression of that, right? It's even fused in museum space into it. And the program itself is an art guide. So, I haven't seen a whole lot of the ones now. I don't think it's not as extreme.
But there's like a big book phenomenon too, right? Because so I work on 16th century Chaucer editions, and Chaucer gets set up as the like paradigm for English poetry. And he has to be printed in the largest collection of English poetry for 150 years, right? So there's something to like printing a really big book that says this book refers to a concept, whether it's a built stadium or the idea of a poet that has exactly important sense that extends beyond itself, right? So I think thinking about the kind of like material choices around creating that book, like something just about the half of it, right? Spoke to like really on an intuitive level, but I think there's a lot to that.
Yeah.
I was really struck by two things about that, about Ben, you're talking about this book. One is that it seems like the Astrodome is so aggressively redefining the stadium, as you're saying, and just like it seems really aggressive, like taking it out of what it had started to be, something that was a more, you know, more democratic community with many classes and colors and so forth, and the sense of walls and even a ceiling is really striking in thinking about that. But it's also so similar to what happens to other public spaces like the theater. So I don't know if you know about the Astor Place riots in the mid-19th century, but Astor Place is built to redefine the theater in a really similar way as it seems the Astrodome is built. Because now, and the prices are all gone, the tickets are going to cost more, there are going to be no more low-class people in the balcony throwing things and being too loud and all of that. So it's just really an interesting thing in parks. There's something with parks, too. Then the other thing was a future thing. I thought, isn't some of the propaganda around the Astrodome kind of galvanizing for the space program and NASA and making people have this faith in the idea that, yeah, we're going to the moon, we're like this expanding, and yeah, it seems like it, and I don't know, yeah, it seems, I wondered what kinds of books there were at that point getting people psyched about NASA.
I mean, just very definitely riding the coattails of NASA, which, I mean, people don't know, you know, is whatever, 20 miles south of Houston.
Yes,
it started, it's right in 1962, I think, is when it opens.
Okay.
So it's the space city, and the original baseball team that they get is called the Colt 45s.
which
is 1962. Right, no, there's this great photo, it's actually in the book. It's 1962, they're the Colt 45s. When they move into the Astrodome, out of their temporary stadium, they become the Astros. The groundbreaking for the Astrodome is a bunch of these Texas politicians in suits with cowboy hats on, with six shooters shooting them, and that's how they break ground. Right? Just like a perfect union of like cowboy and spaceman. Houston represents. Yes, on the frontiers.
Right.
All right, Marilyn, and then Eva, and then I think we need to wrap up the discussion. And I'll say the here.
So, two quick comments. As a really radical librarian, I think keywords are doing ways of getting I'm also fascinated. I've never heard the term revolutionary applied to lithograph. So thank you very much for that. When you said that the lithograph revolutionized the production.
Oh, mimeographs.
Mimeographs,
yeah.
Me.
Yeah.
That's
what
I'm
saying. Yeah. I'm using mimeographs. What's that?
They still use them.
No, I think it's a bit too hard to find some.
Well, yes and no.
I don't know who's using it.
There are still,
I don't
know there, the same way that the sort of the Renaissance on a bunch of old tech.
Yeah.
You know, there are people, the same way people are actively seeking out Vandercooks to do particular types of letterpress, there are people actively seeking old mimeo and multiples of old mimeo, because the only way you can fix a broken mimeo is to vandalize an already damaged one.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah, but it tends to be nichier.
Yeah.
It tends to be.
Still
you know, yeah. It tends to be people who want to sniff mimeo.
Those are my comments, but those are my questions. There is a lithograph picture on Swan's Island here in Venus.
There's also a Chandler and Price in the basement here that's broken, so if anyone has a Chandler and Price flattened press that we can cannibalize, just talk to me after.
My question concerns, I think I just heard you say that it was the white editor that eventually pushed out the one you're talking about.
No, it was a white owner.
White owner, so yes. I'm wondering about, for lack of a better term, whatever, the whiteness of the concept of a literature. And did the white owner, in fact, have certain ideas that turned out to be, you said this a little bit, this wasn't obvious. Was there some way in which the very whiteness of that format was not satisfactory for what its original editor wanted to do eventually?
What do you mean whiteness of the format?
Well, that's what I'm still trying to unpack. But I just got this sense that
you have a literary magazine.
Exactly. Is a white privilege kind of a format, and that here were, if it was a black editor working to bring about things, as you say, education.
Who's the new editor? The new editor is, I think, Fred Moore. So he's associated with the owner. But
I think, I mean, you were getting at something there with this, but I think it's more about kind of the fear of the literary motivated, marshaling radical emotions or rebellious emotions. So one of the reasons why he was against her novel, Contending Forces, is that because it's kind of revisiting the slave, part of the past of slavery.
Sure.
And for him, the new white owner, the point of his journal was to only celebrate like successes. It's kind of a very, very conservative idea. And not
fairly white project.
Yeah. And not a kind of thinking about any kind of revolutionary potential across the world. And she's really invested in this kind of revolution of even though she herself is kind of conservative in other ways. So literature becomes for him, I think, potentially radical or potentially rebellious form, because it is about, because you can't really write historical novels about African Americans without mentioning slavery. You can, but it's very difficult. And for him, that was kind of the problem. You know, stop doing these historical novels that are about slavery, connecting slavery to Jim
Crow. Business and economics.
Yes.
But not talk about the foundation of slavery.
Yes.
The foundation of the economics.
And within the second one, you can easily say, here are these successes with literature.
Sure.
Because higher literature is always about kind of pathos and tragedy. There will be
emotions.
Yeah, and history.
Eva? My question is for Kim. I was wondering if you've noticed any kind of change with the way the internet has changed distribution of the zine in like the collective identity of the author, and if that's changed at all, like with the personalized Etsy page versus the more anonymous kind of go into a bookstore in the middle, and it's just there.
Yes and no, because there's usually a storefront then identity, but then a lot of folks, if they can, will go to in table at a Zoom event as well, and sort of have that cohesive relationship between, well, here I have a sort of my interface with my storefront, but then you can also get them from in this physical way by sort of having a conversation with me. It's just really, again, the internet has just opened up sort of geographic connections. I mean, really, and then people who, for example, there is a woman in the Middle East who, it's a great story, she writes in her zine about the fact that she was almost arrested for distributing her zine because of the content. So, but we were able to get them, and so it's sort of like, for some people, it's still a mode of that could be controversial for them or dangerous, risky for them to be able to distribute. So for some people, if you look at it as a form of a classing and a privileging, it's like, yeah, we take for granted, but other people who may not have, they sort of, here we have these technological needs. For some people, that's going to get you arrested still. So kind of think about it in terms of, you know, what's available to what writers, if anything that's been happening, interesting to know what happens, points of access. Does that answer your question?
I think I was kind of more aiming toward the idea of like the collective identity of the authorship of the zine, how it kind of seems like from the images you showed that it was no author almost, or how
yeah.
It was just so many people that it was kind of
manifesto.
Right.
What's
that? The manifesto for a movement. This is the
movement.
Right.
Well, there were authors at the time, a lot of times that they were, people still write under pen names and things like that, but it was more dangerous to do that at the time for certain materials. A friend of mine who's part of my collective, she used to write under a pen name because she was writing about abortion rights, and she'd get mail on things like that, so she wrote under pen name. And so, for certain people, I think that anonymity is still very important, but at the same time, I think people want to have identity as far as their relationship. So we want to, you know, we want to be able to build community. And I think it depends on how you identify. You just don't, they have an identity, it's perhaps okay. So as far as the changing of that, I mean, maybe not really, other than sort of perhaps it's sort of,
sort of unveiled a lot of voices in the trans community as far as like, how people identify would be, for example, how this and that changes in the scenes as well, and who is
I think we're going to stop here now in the interest of time. These are a series of interlocking conversations that I think could carry on indefinitely. I hope that they will. Just before we wrap things up, I wanted to kind of pull out a few connecting strands from the three sessions that we've had today. I've asked my students who have got to know all of you a little bit through introducing you and you know, sitting and being in dialogue with you today to you know, send me their thoughts. And so this doesn't include, you know, our most recent conversation, but I did want to, you know, the title of this session, this symposium, is Varieties of Textual Experience. And I wanted just to recap briefly by talking and kind of summarizing about some of the varieties of textual experiences that those of you in the room saw unfolding today. And there's really four different strands that kind of came up again and again in the things that folks shared with me. First is the importance of translation. In terms of both the literal and metaphorical. Second is materiality. Third is control and the relationship between text and truth. And the fifth and final thing is the personal and individual and subjective nature of all of this. So I'll just say a few words about each of these. First, we saw migration and translation come up repeatedly at both the micro level, thinking here about the manuscript-to-manuscript differences in the case of the Chaucer miscellanies that Lisa talked about this morning, and even the misordering of individual leaves in the manuscript that Sonia discussed when we began, or, for example, the capitalization of Negro. In the text that Marina talked about. So both the micro level and translation at the macro level, whether we're thinking about the movement from an oral to a written tradition, in the case of the Rwandan text that Sarah discussed, or the movement of Moriscos from Spain to North Africa in the archive that Libby is working with. Second, so that's a big theme, but the second thing that came up was the way in which each example of this has a particularity. And this is something that I think came across particularly well, again, in Libby's presentation, but time and time again, we saw examples of the way in which meaning adheres in the form, the material form, as well as the content of books. So I think here, this came up a lot in the discussion of the physical versus the digital. So the massive heft of the binding of that Don Juan Manuel book that Anita discussed, to the very kind of particular impressions that those Episcopal seals, which I loved, it looks like a bunch of bishops kind of standing around having a conversation. And you can just imagine those kind of rustling. But there's also a question of iteration, right? There's multiple examples of those seals. Zines are copied and copied again, and so on and so forth. So then the third theme that came out of responses was questions of individual human agency and control in the production of this of a text. And I think this came up in pretty clear ways in all three panels. Trying to sort of better understand how attending to the questions raised by these materials open up new perspectives on the way we think about the relationship between textual representation and truth. And I thought Sarah's paper and her suggestion that this came out, I guess, in dialogue between Sonia and Sarah, this idea that a text might be a libretto or a script, right, rather than some immutable truth set in stone or at least in ink. And then finally, and I thought that this came out really well in both Ben and Kim's presentation, the way in which these questions are always personal ones, not just for the folks producing these texts, but for readers and those of us who take it as our scholarly focus, the interpretation of these material as well. Particularly in a number of texts, Sarah, Kim, these are not questions that are just about the past. Right. These speak to issues that I think all of us in this room confront and think about, not just in our scholarly lives, but in our day-to-day existence.
So I don't have answers to all of the questions that were raised today, but I think they're really good ones. And I hope that for our presenters and for those of you in the audience, that this has been a galvanizing day that provides you with material for thought. So before we close, I'd like to say a last round of thank yous. First and foremost to our presenters, many of whom have made time in very busy semester teaching schedules to be here with us today. I'd like also to thank the students in my History of the Book class who've not only been active participants here today, but have been crucial in terms of kind of being a sounding board over the planning process. I'd also like to thank Aaron Rhodes and Pat Burdick from Special Collections at Colby, who not only let us borrow their lovely room for the day, but were extremely helpful and generous in terms of logistical assistance. They're not here right now, but also Carol O'Neill and Megan Fawcett at the Center for Arts and Humanities here at Colby, not only for generous financial support, but also for indispensable logistical source. Support on the part of Megan Fawcett in particular. I said, I want to order this catering. Megan said, no, no, you don't want to order that catering. she really steered me in the right direction. I'd also like to thank the English department here at Colby for additional financial support, and in particular, Lori Osborne, who has been a source of great enthusiasm and support throughout. And then last but not least, I'd also like to thank, in absentia, Rare Book School and the Mellon Fellowship in Critical Bibliography, which has also provided financial support as well as created an intellectual context for this. I know Sonia and Kim through Rare Book School, Lisa and Joel are fellows as well. There's some literature on the back table if you're interested in going to summer camp for nerds for a week this summer. Talk to one of us, we're very evangelical about it. But again, please join me in thanking our participants. Thank you.